Yara Gambirasio should only have been gone a short while. On Friday, the 26th of November 2010 at 5:15 p.m., she left home to go to the gym just a few hundred meters from her home. Yara, who was 13 and wore train track braces, was preparing for her rhythmic gymnastics display the following Sunday. All she needed to do was drop off a stereo with her instructor. She said goodbye to her family, who knew where she was going, and left the house. By 7 p.m. Yara had still not come home and her parents were becoming increasingly anxious. The town where they lived was a sedate place on the so-called Bergamask Island between the rivers Brembo and Adda. An hour north of Milan and just south of the Bergamo Alps, it has a population of 8,000. From its quiet streets, lined with poplars and cypresses, you can see the wooded mountains in the distance, the peaks turning blue-gray. At 7:11 p.m., Yara's mother phoned her daughter, but the call went straight to voicemail. 20 minutes later, Yara's father called the police. The call was put through to the public prosecutor's office, in the center of the provincial capital Bergamo, a city 11 kilometers east of Brembo Te di Sopra. The magistrate on duty was Letizia Ruggeri, a tough former policewoman who had earned her stripes fighting Cosa Nostra in Sicily. She had been a magistrate for almost 15 years, and knew what needed to be done. Within minutes she had dispatched both state police officers and Carabinieri, military police to Brembo Te di Sopra. Yara's instructor confirmed that she had seen the teenager earlier that day and that she had done some light training before heading off. The police quickly established that the last known contact with Yara was a text message she had sent to a friend, Martina, at 6:44 p.m., agreeing to meet at 8 a.m. the following Sunday. That was the last anyone heard from her. The gym was part of a large sports complex, a garish building with many entrances and exits. Besides the large sports hall, there was a running track, a swimming pool, and various courts. A few people said they'd seen two men, possibly in conversation with Yara, standing near a red car, but there was little more to go on than that. Ruggeri called in tracker dogs, a breed of bloodhound, Segugio Italiano, with short brown and black hair, long ears, doleful eyes, and a keen sense of smell. Instead of following the expected route back to Yara's home in Via Rampinelli, Ruggeri's dogs went in the opposite direction towards a small hamlet nearby, called Mapello. When the team analyzed the last signals from Yara's mobile phone, the result showed that it had been registered as present in Mapello at 18:49 that evening. Everything seemed to point away from Yara's family, but investigations of this type always start at home. Over the next few days, Ruggeri and her team questioned every member of the Gambirasio family, looking for signs of discord or dark secrets. Yara's parents were well known and respected. Her father, Fulvio, was a large solid man with thick glasses, an architect whose father had been the local postman, like his mother before him. Mora, Fulvio's wife, was a teacher in Longello, a nearby town. The marriage appeared strong and they had four children. Yara had an older sister, who was 15, and two younger brothers, both under 10. Ruggeri put wiretaps on hundreds of phones. Her team also tried to trace the owners of all the handsets, some 15,000 which had passed through Mapello on the day of Yara's disappearance. One of these belonged to a Moroccan man called Mohamed Fakri. In one wiretapped conversation, in late November, the interpreter heard the phrase, "Forgive me God, I didn't kill her." Fakri had been working in a builder's yard in Mapello, but by the time investigators had put the pieces together a few days later, he was on a boat bound for Tangiers. On the 4th of December, Italian authorities intercepted the vessel and arrested Fakri. They searched the van he had been using and discovered that it contained a blood-stained mattress. People liked him as the guilty party, said Ruggeri, because he was foreign. But Fakri was quickly cleared. The phrase had been mistranslated, and the blood was extraneous to the investigation. As autumn slipped into winter, the small town found itself at the center of a mystery which had captured the country's imagination. Italian TV is dominated by crime news, and now national camera crews descended. The Gambirasio family were horrified by the sudden glare of publicity. TV cameras became a permanent fixture in their quiet cul-de-sac. the family locked themselves away, lowering their shutters and even turning down the idea of a torch-like procession to raise awareness. Instead, nuns from the Ursuline order who taught at Yara's school came to pray with Mora. A mass was held instead of the procession, and the rare statements from the parents were devout pleas for privacy and patience. The reticence of the Gambirasio family reflected the culture of this region. The province of Bergamo is much closer to Switzerland than Naples, and the Bergamaschi are generally more reserved than the southern countrymen. "It's in the spirit of mountain people to disdain gossip and not to repeat nonsense," said Piero Bonicelli, the editor of Arabera, a colorful local newspaper. "If I don't know something, if I have only heard it said, I don't say anything until I'm certain it's true." Desperate to discover the whereabouts of their daughter, the Gambirasio family did share some photographs of Yara with the press in the days after her disappearance. Yara queuing to take communion, doing the splits in the gym, a studio photo of her in a yellow top, in an Italy football shirt, or on the beach. But no one came forward with any useful information. When her parents finally made a televised appeal, a few days after their first Christmas without Yara, they looked awkward. Mora was so uncomfortable she was unintentionally rolling her eyes. Fulvio, who wore a rugby shirt, hesitantly read a plea. "Help us return to normality." He explained that the family values were love, respect and honesty, and that they would be giving no interviews. On the afternoon of the 26th of February 2011, exactly 3 months after Yara disappeared, a middle-aged man named Ilario Scotti was flying his radio-controlled plane in the small town of Cignolo di Sola, 10 kilometers south of Brembati di Sopra. Cignolo is surrounded by industrial estates, and the scrubland seemed like a safe, unpopulated place for Scotti to try out his new model aircraft. The model aeroplane wasn't functioning as Scotti wanted though, so he brought it down to earth amid the tall weeds. As he picked up his plane, he caught sight of some rags on the ground nearby. At first, he thought someone had been fly-tipping. Then he saw the shoes. Ruggeri was coming back from a day skiing with her daughter when she got the call that a body had been found. She dropped her daughter at home and went straight to the crime scene. The body was in an advanced state of decomposition, but Ruggeri could see the black bomber jacket with its elasticated waist which Yara had been wearing when she left home in November. There too, was her Hello Kitty sweatshirt. Crime scene investigators found Yara's iPod and house keys, as well as the SIM card and battery for her phone. The phone itself was missing. Ruggeri stated, "It was a relief. Yara's disappearance had really disturbed me. I'm a mother too, and the only thing worse than the death of a child is the disappearance of a child." The autopsy was conducted by Italy's most famous forensic pathologist, Professor Cristina Cattaneo. She discovered traces of lime in Yara's respiratory passages, and the presence of jute, a vegetable fiber used to make rope, on her clothing. She had suffered multiple injuries from a sharp weapon which had pierced her clothing at various points. It seemed that she had been attacked and abandoned. She had died of exposure. The presence of lime and jute suggested the killer might be in the building trade. The forensics team retrieved two DNA samples, one from Yara's phone battery and the other from two fingers of her black gloves, but neither matched any samples the authorities had on record. 2 months later, the commander of the Scientific Investigations Department in Parma phoned Ruggeri. "I've got good news. This crime has a signature. We've found male DNA on the underwear of the deceased." It was likely that the killer had himself been wounded in the struggle, leaving his DNA on the girl's knickers. Ruggeri and her team named the suspect Ignoto 1. That's Italian for Unknown One. Now the hunt for Yara's killer could begin in earnest. But the workload was huge, and Ruggeri divided up the duties. The police were responsible for taking DNA samples from family members, from school friends and people in the gym. The Carabinieri concentrated on the phone records, cross-referencing all the mobile phones that had moved from Brembate di Sopra to Cignolo di Sola on the 26th of November 2010. Each phone user whose number appeared in both cells was tracked down and asked for a DNA sample. It was slow and laborious work. it took geneticists in Parma, Pavia, and Rome a minimum of 6 hours to transform just a few samples of DNA into something which could be read and compared on a computer screen. The cost, in machinery and manpower, was immense, and the investigation would go on to become one of the most expensive manhunts in Italian history. Yara's funeral took place on a hot morning in late May 2011. Onlookers applauded the white coffin, which was topped with a huge bouquet of white flowers, as the hearse slowly drove towards her gym. The ceremony took place in the sports hall where she had spent so many hours training and where she had last been seen alive. Outside, a large crowd watched the funeral on a giant screen and heard the condolences of Giorgio Napolitano, the President of the Republic. By the time of the funeral, investigators had taken thousands of DNA samples, but they still had no leads. Close to the scrubland where Yara's body had been found was a nightclub called Sabi Mobili, Italian for quicksand. Ruggeri knew that murderers tend to dump bodies in areas with which they're very familiar, so although it seemed like a long shot, in spring 2011 investigators started taking DNA samples outside the club on busy Fridays and Saturdays. Sabi Mobili had a reputation for violence. A young man from the Dominican Republic was killed outside its doors on the 16th of January 2011, but the club had helpful records. Clubbers required a membership card to get in, and so the authorities could easily track down anyone who went there regularly. Ruggeri finally got a break. One of the samples from Sabi Mobili seemed strikingly similar to the suspect, Ignato One. The man who gave the sample was called Damiano Gerinoni. He was quickly excluded as a suspect. He had been in South America on the day Yara disappeared, but geneticists were convinced he was a close relative of the killer. As Ruggeri and her team put together the jigsaw of Gerinoni's family, they made an astonishing discovery. Damiano Gerinoni's mother, Aurora Zani, had worked for 10 years as a domestic help in the Gambirasio home. She lived nearby and had gone to Yara's home twice a week throughout the young girl's childhood. Zani was a middle-aged woman who was very attached to her employers. She recalled how Yara would always ask her to watch her latest gymnastics moves, and Zani would tell her to be careful not to hurt herself. In 2011, she was no longer working for the family but said her relationship with Yara's parents was excellent. To find herself at the center of the investigation into Yara's death was, Zani said later, the worst thing that could happen to me. Ruggeri intercepted Damiano Gerinoni and Aurora Zani's calls and had them followed in plain sight. It was only after months of close surveillance that Ruggeri, in the summer of 2011, resigned herself to the fact that it was just a crazy coincidence. Having seemed so close to a resolution, Ruggeri's team reluctantly discarded the angle of the domestic help. The only promising lead they still had was the fact that Damiano Gerinoni's DNA was so similar to that of Ignato One. A year on from Yara's death, Ruggeri's team was now under intense pressure to find the killer. Thousands of people were being DNA tested, and some locals who hadn't been approached for a sample suggested to the press that the investigation was haphazard. Politicians made personal attacks on Ruggeri. One Northern League politician, Daniele Bellotti, publicly decried her incompetence, writing an open letter in January 2012 to the Minister of Justice asking for her to be replaced by someone of proven experience. Ruggeri filed a lawsuit against Bellotti for libel on the 20th of April 2012, taking particular objection to his characterization of her as a person of low technical and moral profile. Ruggeri decided to concentrate on the only promising lead she had, the Gerinoni DNA. Her team spent months recreating the Gerinoni family tree. She had a whole folder with hundreds of names, each one annotated, dates of birth, places of birth, relationships within the family. The investigators had worked out a complete genealogical tree as far back as 1815, with other branches of the family going back as far as 1716. The roots of that family tree were in the small village of Gorno. It's only 45 minutes drive north of Bergamo itself, up the narrow Soriana Valley, but it feels like another world. You arrive through a series of hairpin bends into a village that smells of wood smoke and chickens. although only 1,600 people live in Gorno and it seems like a quiet, pious place, according to one former parish, the village is a bit too hot, in every sense. Let's say they're a bit promiscuous. In 2011, two people in Gorno were killed in unrelated incidents. The same families have been here for centuries, and on the village's war memorial, outside the small church, the names of Benedetto and Pietro Gerinoni are carved into the stone. The Gerinoni family were nicknamed Gli Fanti, the infantry, considered by everyone to be loyal, strong, even hot-headed. Damiano Gerinoni's father had a brother, Giuseppe, who had died in 1999. Investigators visited Giuseppe's widow in September 2011 and found two stamps he had licked. One in order to validate his driving license and another on a postcard he had sent to his family. When DNA results came back from that sample, they had another breakthrough. Geneticists were convinced that Giuseppe Gerinoni was the father of Ignato I, the suspected killer. Ruggeri's team quickly built up a picture of Giuseppe Gerinoni and his family. Giuseppe himself, a thick-set man with a rugged face, had been a bus driver who played the accordion at village festivals. His marriage to Laura Polly had seemed conventional. They had three children, a girl and two boys. Laura had become a Jehovah's Witness, and after her husband's death had moved to a nearby town, Cluzone. Since Ignato I was male, investigators concentrated on the sons, Pierpaolo and Diego. Pierpaolo was like his mother, a Jehovah's Witness. Diego had a drug problem. Neither provided a perfect match with Ignato I, however, and neither of them had children. If Ignato I really was the son of the late Giuseppe Gerinoni, the only explanation was that, somewhere out there, was his illegitimate child. It became an investigation within an investigation. Ruggeri was now hunting a woman, presumably in middle to old age, who 30 or 40 years ago had had an affair with a married man, now long dead, and given birth to a boy who went on to kill Yara Gambirasio. It proved extremely difficult for investigators to penetrate the mountain villages where they were looking for clues and leads. Some Italian journalists spoke of the cocciutaggine, or pig-headedness of the Bergamo Alps. A caricature which only served to antagonize the already defensive locals. The people here were irritated by the stereotype of Highlanders closed in on themselves. The word omerta was used, which implies the silence of Sicily and the mafia. There was incomprehension on both sides. The investigation was, by Italian standards, unusually secretive. Locals couldn't understand why police hunting the killer of a 13-year-old girl were taking the DNA samples of elderly women. Locals felt there was something cold about this investigation, with its invasive demands for DNA samples. And it was changing the atmosphere in these small communities. People thought that the killer was there, amongst them. So there was a sort of, not panic, but fear. Investigators knew that from the early 1960s onwards, for 2 weeks every May, Giuseppe Gerinoni used to go to a spa resort called Salice Terme, south of Milan, without his wife. Throughout the spring of 2012, Ruggeri's team scoured records and registers, tracking all the women who had stayed in the resort at the same time of year as Gerinoni. They searched orphanages and homes for fallen women, they tested single mothers and women who had left the mountains for Lower Bergamo. They came up empty-handed. The woman they were looking for, they realized, was probably neither single nor fallen, but hidden behind the walls of a marriage. Divorce was only legalized in Italy in 1970. Until that time, many couples had stayed together despite infidelities. By the time Ruggeri was searching for Ignato I's mother, Yara's parents had hired their own expert, a freelance geneticist, in order to review the investigation and explain it to them. For almost a year, Giorgio Portera lobbied for the exhumation of Giuseppe Gerinoni's body from the cemetery in Gorno. He was concerned that investigators had only been able to compare 13 short tandem repeat regions, or STR, which are sequences of DNA, with the DNA of Ignato I. Confirmation of paternity demands that at least 15 STR regions be compared. Early on the 7th of March 2013, workmen chiseled into Gerinoni's loculo, the horizontal slot in a cemetery wall where his coffin was kept, and removed his remains. They were transferred by Carabinieri to the Papa Giovanni Hospital in Bergamo for examination before being returned to Gorno just a few hours later. A couple of camera crews and a few bewildered villagers watched. When DNA was extracted from his remains, 29 STR regions could be compared. It was now absolutely certain that Gerinoni was the father of Ignoto I. As the investigation dragged on through 2013, the public slowly became aware of why a woman was being sought. It became common knowledge that the late Giuseppe Gerinoni had had a lover and that she was thought to be the mother of the killer. Long-forgotten infidelities and old suspicions surfaced. Bonicelli laughs as he describes how his journalists discovered 5 illegitimate children in 2 small villages. 5. We could have started a gossip magazine. It was like an open sewer. We were receiving anonymous letters, stories, people telling us about backgrounds and cuckolds. A society which had always prided itself on its sense of loyalty and traditional Catholicism suddenly discovered the betrayals in its midst. Until this point, the investigation had been characterized by cutting-edge, scientific analysis, but it was an old-fashioned detective who broke the case open. Marshal Giovanni Moserino was Ruggeri's right-hand man, working in the office next to hers. His desk is covered in hundreds of scraps of paper, scrawled with names and numbers in different colored inks. Moserino has bushy gray hair and black-rimmed glasses and speaks in a light-hearted, informal manner. But he's also, by his own admission, a capitosta. A stubborn man. Although Moserino was born in the south, near Naples, he had lived in the Bergamo Alps area since 1983 and he had come to know the region well. He was always talking with local people and sensitized, as he said, thousands to the case. He reminded them that amid all the gossip about infidelities that had been sparked off by the hunt for Gerinoni's lover, a young girl had been killed. By 2013, he knew everything about Gerinoni's life. Born in Gorno, Gerinoni had moved in the mid-1960s to Ponte Selva, a nearby settlement which had grown up around the bridge over the Sirio River. He drove a public bus for the Motolini Bus Company, later called SAB. In the 1960s and 70s he would have driven plenty of young women to and from jobs in the various textile factories. Moserino questioned Gerinoni's fellow bus drivers, one of whom had already gone to the press in March 2013 saying that Gerinoni had confessed to having got a young woman in trouble. Another former colleague described Gerinoni as a man with a capital M, implying that he was a womanizer. But it wasn't until June 2014 that one of Moserino's sources finally gave him the name he was looking for. Moserino has always protected his sources and refuses to confirm who first whispered the name of the mystery woman to him. But however it came about, investigators had the final piece of the jigsaw. Her name is Esther Arzufi. Arzufi had been a neighbor of Gerinoni's in Ponte Selva in the late 1960s. In 1966, at the age of 19, she had married Gianni Bossetti from Par, a nearby village. Bossetti was a man whose tough life had turned him inwards. He had been orphaned young and suffered from psoriasis, arthrosis and depression. Arzufi seemed very different, an outgoing, good-looking woman. She wore short skirts and dyed her hair. She got a job at the textile factory a few miles away in Villa Donia and took the bus every day. Ruggeri's team immediately cross-checked the DNA samples they had and discovered that Arzufi had already been tested in July 2012. They double-checked and realized that a basic error had been made by a geneticist in Rome. Arzufi's DNA had been compared not to Ignoto I's, but to Yara's. Now investigators hurriedly rerun the test and discovered that Arzufi was, indeed, the woman they had spent so long looking for. She was definitely the mother of Ignoto I. Arzufi had left Ponte Selva in 1970, but she had continued her affair with Gerinoni, and in the autumn of 1970 she gave birth to twins. A boy and a girl. The boy was called Massimo Bossetti and his middle name was Giuseppe, like his biological father. A slim boy who loved to party, he was nicknamed the animal by his friends. He was now 42, a builder, married with three children and living in Mapello, the hamlet near Yara's hometown where the last signal from Yara's cell phone had been recorded on the 26th of November 2010. He was short, with piercing blue eyes, and had a peroxided, pencil goatee. Ruggeri moved fast. On the 15th of June 2014, she set up a fake roadblock breathalyzing drivers. When her police officers stopped Massimo Bossetti, they pretended the machine hadn't worked the first time, so they could get two good samples. His DNA was immediately sent for overnight tests and results showed it was an exact match with Ignato 1. Ruggeri wanted to observe Bossetti before arresting him, to study his movements and behavior from a distance, but she was also worried that the news would get out and that he might leave town. On the 16th of June, Bossetti was arrested and charged with the killing of Yara Gambirasio. The Italian Home Secretary himself released a statement announcing his arrest. Reaction in the mountains of Bergamo, center of the investigation, was relief. The suspect was from Lower Bergamo. Investigators discovered plenty of circumstantial evidence. Bossetti had frequently hung around Yara's house. He parked his car in Via Don Sala, behind the gym, and ate at the Toscanaccia pizzeria, at the end of her road. He had gone for regular UV showers, at a tanning shop nearby. His internet searches were troubling, using search words which implied a compulsion for pubescent young girls. More pertinently, records suggested that his phone had been present in Brembatedi Sopra on the evening of Yara's disappearance, but had been switched off from 5:45 p.m. until the following morning at 7:34 a.m. For Ruggeri, the arrest was the reward for almost 4 years of dogged investigative work. After enduring a barrage of criticism for alleged incompetence, she was now fated for her brilliance. On July 1, 2016, the Bergamo Court of Assizes sentenced Massimo Bossetti to life imprisonment for killing Yara Gambirasio and acquitted him of the charge of slander. The court also recognizes the aggravating circumstance of cruelty and revokes Bossetti's parental authority over his three children, but is not accepted the request of the public prosecutor, who had also asked for the accused isolation during the day for 6 months. The court ordered compensation for each parent and each brother of Yara and for the lawyers. The appeal process began on the 30th of June 2017. The defense exhibits as new evidence a satellite photo, claiming that the body of the victim was moved and the DNA deposited long after the crime, something denied by the prosecution and the judgment of the first instance. On July 17, 2017, the Court of Appeal of Brescia confirms the judgment of the first instance of judgment, finding Bossetti guilty and sentencing him to life imprisonment. On October 12, 2018, the Court of Cassation confirmed Bossetti's life sentence. Meanwhile, three families are dealing with the devastation of the case. Gerinoni's widow has been forced, in the autumn of her life, to come to terms with her husband's infidelity and the existence of his other children. Meanwhile, just as he was diagnosed with terminal cancer, Giovanni Bossetti became the nation's most famous cuckold, learning at the same time as the rest of the country that none of his three children are his. Leaks from the investigation revealed that Esther Arzufi's third child, Fabio, also had a different father. The marriage of the accused, Massimo Bossetti, has also come under strain, since his defense sought to portray him as a family man. Two people have come forward to claim that they had affairs with his wife. Such is the local loathing for Bossetti that since his arrest, his twin sister, herself coming to terms with both her brother's fate and the fact that the man she thought was her father is not biologically related to her, has twice been beaten up. Her mother, Esther Arzufi, still denies that she's ever been unfaithful to her husband. The Gambirasio family, meanwhile, has remained private. Awarding a gymnastics trophy named after her daughter, Maura Gambirasio struggled to smile and made no public comments. She's cut her hair short and looks gaunt. Yara is buried between her two grandparents in a cemetery, just across the road from her gym. There's no date on her tombstone, only a signature next to a photograph of her wearing a white Alice band. All around the grave are mementos left by her friends, gym shoes, a metal tulip, rag dolls, plastic angels and little bracelets. Often, in the early evening, you see Yara's father, Fulvio, standing here, gazing at the resting place of his parents and his daughter. This story was written by Tobias Jones, courtesy of Guardian News and Media Limited. The links are in the description.